So if your objective function and constraints are not functions of a particular variable, okay, like for example, I used what color I'm going to put on the can, and my cost is, let's say, it doesn't matter, every color costs me the same. So my cost does, that variable doesn't appear on either of my constraints or my objective function. You can put anything there, so it's not, so you have a free ride there, you can choose anything. The fact that you have chosen that as a variable, somehow it should reflect in your objective function and constraints. So if not, you can come back and delete that, cut that off as a variable. Okay? That's not going to affect the final thing. But sometimes it's tricky. Sometimes the objective functions may have less number of variables than what you have considered, but those variables which do not appear in the objective function appears in the constraint functions. Okay? Then that problem, that variable is also important, because it determines whether a solution is feasible or not. And I showed you in the very first slide that the constraints actually chops up certain part of the search region, so it's important. So constraint satisfaction is the first most important thing in optimization. You cannot give me a solution that is outside this feasible region. The fact that I told you 330 milliliter is needed, if you give me a design with 250 milliliter inside, I cannot take your design. I cannot then fabricate it, right? No matter how low it cost me, I cannot, because I wanted to have at least 330 milliliter. So constraint satisfaction is the most important part. And if some variables are involved in that and not doesn't appear in objective function, it's fine. You still, that is an important thing. Algorithms work in this way, that you start with, so once these constraint surfaces are identified in your, so this is again a two variable kind of sketch I'm talking about, you start with the initial guess. And then as soon as you've used the algorithm has a way to determine which direction to search from that point. So from this point here, it goes in that direction and finds the best point, okay? It doesn't search in all n-dimensional space, no, it's only search in that direction. And then that's the end of one iteration. Next iteration, now that you're here, the algorithm says go in that direction, and you will go and find the best point along that. This is how you continue before you come close to the optimum. Now you may wonder, why didn't it take the shortcut and come here, like going this way? That's something to do with the algorithm. Algorithm was designed not for a particular problem. It was a generic algorithm, maybe with gradient information, maybe with some other information locally speaking along that initial, around that initial guess. And that turned out to be the best direction the algorithm suggests, so you have to follow this. So as soon as you're using somebody else's algorithm, you don't have too much freedom. You just have to follow that, but you have the freedom to blame it at the end. Say, oh, it's not a good method. Okay, for my problem. But you change your problem to another problem, maybe that algorithm is the best one now, because whoever has designed it probably had this kind of problem in mind. That's where the NFL, the no freelance theorem, comes in, which we'll get into. But you have a question?
Sir, here is the variable. One is that how the gradient will go and how much will jump.
Yeah. Yeah, all these are there. We'll talk about the algorithms tomorrow, okay, how it depends on the gradient, yeah. But here I'm talking you the principles of optimization. This is point-based, the principles of point-based optimization methods. You start with a point, algorithm suggests which way to go and how much to go. As soon as you got that, that's the end of one iteration, then the algorithm says, now that you're here, go in this direction. This is the best direction, and you go again. So you repeatedly use this method, eventually hope of coming close to the optimum, right? Okay, now let's go through a list of problems that are found in practice, which are optimization type. First and foremost are the design and manufacturing problems, okay? So you can see here various types of design problems I've showed you, a cab design, a gearbox design, a airplane wing design, for example, a VLSI design. There are, it doesn't matter which field you come, you always have to do design. Design must have been a course in your undergraduate, right? No matter what field you come from. And a design involves a lot of parameters. Any of these things, now with this knowledge, you can identify some parameters, right, as variables, which you can change. And for example, in the gearbox, how many gears? What is the gear thickness? What is the material? What is the module of the gear? How many gear tooth? So many things I could do, how they should be arranged. What is the objective? Objective function would be the size of the whole gearbox. I want to make it as compact as possible. Another objective could be, I want to have a gearbox that can transmit a maximum number, maximum power. So that means my gear sizes are going to be very thick so that it can, it doesn't break and can transmit lots of power. So different kinds of objectives. Constraints, I want certain variable speeds at the output, right? I give an input speed, I want certain speeds at the output shaft. Am I getting that? If I don't get that, this gearbox doesn't serve it. Like when in your car, when you change gears, it gets certain speed, right? So I want that kind of stuff, right? So no matter which one you take, you can come up with now variables and constraints and objective functions, okay? Now, how do you write this as a mathematical formulation comes from the knowledge of that particular field. So if you're a mechanical engineer, you have done a course on gearing, how these things are calculated, the gears, the speed, the thicknesses, and all these, the gear design. You must have gone through a half a semester course on that, or maybe 1 month on that. Nobody else can do that, okay? So you are the expert in that field. So that's why optimization always needs an expert from the field to provide us these mathematical objective function and constraints. A person who is an expert in biology will not be able to do that, okay? So because you are solving a niche problem from your own field, you have to come up with these things. And that's not an easy effort. That takes about, I would say, 50 to 60% of the whole optimization effort. You have to go back to design gearbooks, to your mechanics books, mostly to your undergraduate material. That's why I think optimization has to be used with at least an undergraduate background from the field. But certain problems can be easy if you're doing finance problems or geometry kind of optimization problems. Oftentimes we need to do that. Then of course you don't need too much knowledge. Here are some examples. I'm not going to go through each of them, but those of you who are in civil engineering or mechanical engineering, working on structural optimization or structure design area, this is a very simple truss. You can go through the stresses that comes through. The objective function is the weight of the whole thing to be minimized. And the constraints come from the stresses at every member should not be more than the strength of the material. And there are some restrictions on the sizes. So here the cross-sectional sizes are the variables. You can have a car design, the suspension design, where there are some suspension parameters, the damper characteristics and the stiffener characteristics. Those are your variables. The constraint would be that that certain, for example, the one of the problems we solved using this is there is a concept called jerk, which is the change of acceleration. Okay, that tells you how comfortable the ride is. But there are some ISO charts which describes what is a comfortable ride. So you want to design this suspension so that the ride is comfortable, and you can specify certain limit on that. Then the objective function can be that the road undulation get transmitted to the passengers moving around with the road as minimum as possible. Although you're going through a big hump, but passenger is not following the hump, okay? There's less variation or displacements that the user have. So different kind of thing you can think of. So these are one kinds of problems. Manufacturing area also, if you're trying to do, let's say, the best operation of a lathe, or of a particular milling machine. So there are a lot of parameters like feeding, speed, rotation, all these different stuff. So you want to design those things so that you have a very smooth cut, or you cut it at the minimum possible time. All these can be your objective functions, right? Switching gear a little bit, there are lots of problems in practice which are inverse type, okay? There is actually a whole field called inverse engineering or inverse problem solving. There is a conference I know completely dedicated to this. The other names for this in mechanical engineering called tomography. I don't know whether you had exposure in any of your courses on tomography, but these are like non-destructive testing. So one other thing would be, let's say, if you take a plate, I think I have an example here. Yeah, this is a plate, and without cutting the plate and figuring out if there is a fault or if there's a crack somewhere, what you could do is you can put some actuator at certain places in the plate and have some receiver at the other end and note down the time of travel of an ultrasonic wave or any kind of wave that you can send. If you have a parent material which is, let's say, notch free or any crack free parent material, you know how much time it takes, right? So the difference between these two times in the actual prototype versus the original one can tell you where the crack is, if there is a crack, what the shape is like. So what you have to do is you've got to have lots of different places where you put the actuators and lots of different places you put the sensors. So when you are measuring all these rays and times, put all of them together in an algorithmic way, you can actually predict how the crack is, if there is a crack. So there was a PhD student of mine who worked on this, and we could predict really the whole shape of the crack by doing by non-destructive way of doing it. I mean, we're not cutting across anything. We're just measuring the time and figuring out what is inside. So these are called inverse problems. Now, why is it inverse? Because to an academic institute on a course, what we do is to the students, we give this course. This is a problem, like I give you a plate and I tell you there is a crack of this nature somewhere in the middle. I give you the exact, let's say there is a hairline crack I give you. And I tell you, if I put an actuator at this point and I put a sensor at that point, how much time it will take for the ray to travel? That's a good problem. It's called a forward problem. Because now you have a system, there is an input, and I want to find out the output. So this is like a system approach that we often teach in engineering and in sciences. This is called forward problem solving. But the problem I just posed is an inverse one, right? I don't know what the crack is, if there is a crack or whether how is the shape. I tell you the numbers when it reaches there from here to there. So I gave you the output and I want to tell you what caused it. Now these kinds of problems are called inverse problems. These are called tomography problem, and oftentimes you have that from brain images or many of those things. These are also one of the ways to solve this problem is through optimization. So one of the things that come in these problems is that there are many, many solutions that will fit in to this time thing that I've talked to you about. So then there is one constraint that comes in. It's called the Occam's razor. What actually means is the simplest looking shape, the simplest looking object. So there could be a solution with all these times I gave you. There is a crack here, there is a crack here, there is a crack there and all there that matches all the time you gave me. Also, there is another solution with a small crack somewhere else in a slightly inclined manner that also matches all the numbers that you gave me, okay? So the constraint should say, take the simplest one, take that one crack instead. So most likely that one has taken place. So again, we don't know, but we often go with these hunches. But in solving such problems, multimodality comes in, which I mentioned, that we find multiple solutions. So this is one problem where you need to find multiple solutions and then argue and see which is possible and which is not. Because when you're solving this as an inverse problem, you are actually solving numerically the problem. It doesn't understand the context, so it can give you all possible solutions. Some of them may make sense, some of them may not make sense. If you know that, you can put those information as a constraints. If you don't know that, then you can later on make the decision. Okay, any question? You have a question?
What is the rate of the success for detecting multiple damages? Talk about that.
Rate of success, yeah, that's a good point. When you know your material, well, it's a very good success we could do. But if your material also is unknown, that means if you tell me there is only crack, I'm interested. Or there is only crack in this thing that I can expect, then it's a two material thing. One is the actual material, the other is air or vacuum, whatever it is, right? So that's not a very difficult problem to solve. But now if you say there could be inserts of different kinds, which also I want to understand. Now the insert material, I don't know. Right? And that's all going to change my time of travel. And your insert materials also is a variable. Now I'm increasing my number of variables. That's a difficult problem. Because there will be many, many combinations of shape and the material which is going to match your time. And that becomes an open problem. Yeah, composite would be a difficult problem to solve because you may expect number of different materials over there. Right. Yeah, so there are limited applications of this. Only thing is that the optimization algorithm needs more time when you have more variables. So if you have computing power and time to use it, then you can eventually get there. Yeah, but yeah, that's a bit of caution that you have to have here. Okay, the other problems are parameter estimation. All of you have used regression, right? A linear fit through a set of data. You do experiments in a lab. You know that it has to come as a straight line. you call a software, right? And the software gives you the line. You know that the software has used an optimization method. It's a least square optimization, yeah. So that's a way to, that's the only way to get there. What it does is it comes up with a line for which the perpendicular distances from each of the point to the line is minimum, if you take an average of all that. Now, tomorrow, you have another set of data points. You're not expecting a line. You're expecting, let's say, a curve. Let's say a periodic curve. You can't use that particular software because that was specifically designed for linear feet. But now that you know there is an optimization method inside, you can come up with your own optimization method with the periodic curve that you're expecting, right? So the basic principle is that an optimization method is used. You can use it for any other regression feet, okay? The other kinds of problem that comes in design of experiments problems. Some of the experiments in biology or even in physics can be very, very expensive. To set up the whole thing requires a lot of money and effort, and then you do the experiments to get some data. Or you do computer simulations, and sometimes it takes days to get the data, particularly if you're using CFD and other things. So let's say you've got 100 data points evaluated. You are trying to get a meta model of your surface so that you know where the good things are. You've got 100 points. You are looking for 101st point. Now, are you going to create that 101st point at random? Probably not, because 100 point gives you a very good idea of the surface, and those 100 points can then give you idea where to put the next point so that you get maximum information out of the function you're trying to model, right? So there is a d-optimality, g-optimality, all these different concepts that are there in design of experiments that uses optimization. So you have some knowledge of some points. You want to create where shall I put the next experiment, because every experiment is expensive. So that's where you can use optimization methods. Okay, switching gear again. Modeling, it's another big area of optimization. This is a sketch of a blast furnace where there are a lot of inputs that come to the furnace. And then after a few hours of operation, you get an output which is the molten iron. Then you go and see the strength of that molten iron. Now, the strength is a function of all those inputs. You want to understand what is the input-output relationships. Now, steel has been produced for more than 100 years, right? Now, they still don't know exactly what goes on. There are a lot of stuff they understand zone-wise, but these are all quite, you know, a lot of assumptions are put in that this is this zone, that is that zone. There are some mushy areas which they're not very clear. But have they stopped them producing steel? No. They still produce steel, and we make bridges and buildings with it and still live on them or go over them, right? They work most of the time, but if you think of understanding steel, is there any metallurgist here from metallurgy? Nobody? Okay. So they can tell us better, but I have worked with metallurgists just like a few years ago. At that point, even they were not sure. I'm not sure if in a couple of years anything has happened. But what they know is that there are a lot of equations like this that you see on the top here, which are known. Maybe zone-wise, maybe some general form of the reaction that takes place, and we can figure out. But they cannot trust them that that's exactly what's going on in practice, because there are sort of a lot of uncertainties in them. Ambient temperature, the operator's mood, okay, it also depends on how much air he let in and all that. It all depends on that. These are sometimes you cannot describe. So what they do is they modify these equations by multiplying with those Greek letters, as you see, gamma, beta, all these they have. Those actually don't exist in the actual equations, but they add those things. Those becomes your variables of the optimization problem. Now you say, okay, I am going to now find out what values I should put as gamma, alpha, beta, all these, so that the output from these equations matches closely with the plant output. Because you usually have plant output for many, many years. Now, you are trying to model that system. So you're trying to find how am I going to modify my equations so that my output of the equation matches well with the input. Now, these kinds of systems are very good for interpolations. Okay, or it doesn't work very well for extrapolations. But all you're doing is, if you have lots of data and you are trying to do an interpolative model, this is a good way to do. So it's an optimization. So you find alpha, beta, gamma through optimization of minimizing the error. Another thing, which I don't know how many of you know, artificial neural network. I'm sure in this campus there's some people talk about or teach about these courses. So this is another way of getting input-output relationships between inputs and outputs, relationships. But in neural net, you don't get the relationships as mathematical functions like you will get in the first case I talked about. But your relationships get, in an abstract way, it gets stored, it gets learned. But you know that the neural network process of learning the weights of the neural network uses an optimization method. So either you use the first one or the top one or the bottom one, optimization is at the core, telling you how to set it, how to get the relationships for modeling purposes. So I've got some examples here. The fourth class of problems where you get into or use optimization, again, a large way is scheduling and routing and planning and some of these things. Classroom scheduling, for example. In this campus, there are so many classes, few classrooms, few teachers, few days in a week, right, you are teaching. And somebody has to make that roster, right, so that not one student is sitting in two different classes at the same time, right? So this will be a constraint which is not allowed to be violated. Similarly, two courses cannot be taught in the same room at the same time, right? All these different constraints will come in. We tried to formulate this for IIT Kanpur one time with an IME student that I had. So many constraints that come in, it's very difficult to find even one feasible solution from scratch. So we had to use some very good solutions, which are the existing solutions now, and then our algorithm was able to modify on it and come up with a much better solution. So sometimes you have to do, so these problems are very, very difficult than the problems we talked about so far. So traveling salesperson is one such problem, where if salesperson has to travel various cities to sell some product, how shall he plan so that there is no crisscrossing? An objective function in such problem is to minimize the overall distance traveled. Other kinds of problems, optimization comes in called optimal control, that some of you have taken a course on control, right? These are the variables in these problems are not just these dimensions that I've mentioned. This is a profile, usually. So it could be that you are controlling, let's say, a nuclear power plant, okay, very important application. So there are certain places you have a pressure gauge, you have a volume flow measuring gauge and temperature gauge and all that stuff. These are your control stuff. You can control them, right? So you see that now you have to have an idea that over time, how shall my pressure be controlled? Or how shall I set my pressure? How shall I set my temperature inside that reactor? Okay? So you will get some kind of a profile here, as you see on the left plot here. You can have a profile, and this could be just the temperature as a function of time at a particular place. If you maintain such a temperature distribution, you get the optimal performance. You get the maximum output of something. So we did one such problem with Tata Steel, where they had a furnace, and the furnace was actually taking a lot of fuel to maintain the temperature. They were interested in me coming up with the optimal temperature setting. So the blooms are passed from one side of the furnace and it goes at a very slow speed with a conveyor belt. And during that process, it's getting heated up. And at the end, they want the temperature anywhere to be at least 1350 with plus minus something given, 10 degrees or 25 degrees. They want a uniform temperature all along with minimum scale in them. So now there are three burners. So we need to figure out how shall we maintain the temperature through those three burners across the furnace so that I need to supply minimum amount of heat and also have that temperature set up. Okay, so these are called control problems. I will introduce you to more control problems later. Here's the crane maneuvering, which I'll talk about later. The other kinds of problems are in finance, for example, forecasting and predictions. There are a lot of companies these days who are trained in optimization area, open up. Some of the PhD students that I had in the past, one of them had opened such a company. One of my colleagues, when I was doing PhD, he was also doing his PhD, and eventually he opened up such a forecasting company. So what you do is, these companies, they have lots of data about the market, okay? How they're doing for last few years, and they always make a model of that. And I talked about the modeling aspect through optimization. If their modeling is good, they can predict it better, maybe for a week, maybe for a month, maybe for a year. It depends on how good is the model. And then if you go for saving your money, all these portfolio managers, right? All these saving companies that you have, that's what they do. They actually invest your money, some amount to this bond, some amount in that bond, so that at the end of a year, they give you a maximum gain. Okay, if they can give you, then you will keep your money with them for a longer time. So that's how they earn money. But the way you forecast it well, then you can, I'm sorry, the model it well, you can predict what goes on in the future. So that's an optimization problem of making a good model so that you can forecast well. The other big application of optimization over the years have come is weather forecasting. Weather these days can be predicted so well. I don't know whether you've seen some of the hurricanes move through US. They predict so well these days because they have a global model and they have this optimization at the core, which is they have a lot of weather stations and weather recording station at various places in the globe, and they're constantly getting data, not only over Earth, but also in the sky. They're constantly getting data. And all they are doing is they are adjusting their model so that the output from their model matches with the data that they're constantly getting. It's a continual process. Okay, now if the hurricane develops, all they have to do is predict with that model how the hurricane is going to go, which way it's going to go. So you observe that they show you up to current point with one solid line, how it has come, because these are all determined now. And from there on, there is a little fuzzy thing. There will be a line, which is the median, then there will be a 25 percentile, 50 percentile, and 75 percentile, and all that, that says with how much confidence they can tell that it's going to be deviating from the median. And as it's moving, these things also move. So there are a lot of sophistication these days. Some of the softwares, which these weather stations will tell you, can reduce. So any model that has the 75 percentile lines are very close to the median means they are predicting well. Okay, if you have a large variance, that means I can even do that. I can even say that over a 200 mile long, this is how it's going to go. But if you can do it with 20 miles, 50 miles range, then you can evacuate those people, right? So with minimum hazard. So a lot of these things, optimization these days has direct social implications. And this is something which I'm very hopeful about, that optimization is now getting into social applications, to first responder systems, how the first responders should respond when a disaster has taken place. Okay, which people to evacuate first, which hospitals to take people first, and so on and so forth. These are not any arbitrary or just when it happens you use your intelligence and do it. You have to plan it. If you see that, okay, for example, New York, there are plans. They've already done because they're the first time when there was a gas leak inside a tube, inside one of those underground metros. They had figured out some key stations. If there is a gas leak, so many people at the office time are going to get affected. And where shall they put, do they have adequate hospitals, first of all, near that? If not, if they have to put two hospitals and two fire stations, where is the best place to put it? So that if disasters happen at these critical locations, very quickly they can evacuate and with minimal loss, So these are, again, optimization problems which you plan ahead, not when it happens, before. So put your money, put your resources at the right place. So all these becomes now important, and some of these methods can go over there. Other thing in today's world is big data. You may have heard, right? It's a big buzzword these days. Everybody's working on big data. Data comes from various sources. First thing you need to do is classify data, saying, okay, this data coming from there, that data coming from here are basically the same thing. So we got to put them in one class. So how do you make these things? You see here, I'm showing you some umbrellas type of thing, is to identify that when data is coming from various places. Once you have done that, now you can look at each class and figure out some other things. So pattern recognition, for example, is another thing. So some of these problems are called machine learning problems. You may have heard through other ways. It's a part of AI, artificial intelligence. But one of the key methodologies at the core is optimization methods. For any of these words that I've said, optimization is a way to solve them. Okay, last but not the least is the machine learning applied to is the robotics. This application actually came from Dilip's work. After Dilip has done, I had another student who really applied some of his concepts into this robot. And one of the things that happened in the robotics area is you don't know where the obstacles are going to be when you are navigating. If you know that, it becomes a simple problem. It's a static problem, but these in dynamic situations, you don't know. So then how can you still solve the problem in an optimal manner, right? So you need to come up with a robot's brain, basically. We came up with a fuzzy rule base by which you can throw the robot in such an environment and it will have a sensor to know where the obstacles are and make its own decision of how to avoid them. But you are providing the brain. So you do an offline optimization of finding out if many situations like that had happened, what is the optimal solution in terms of a rule base. And this is exactly what I mentioned before about child becoming an adult. It's an optimization process is that. We actually work with rule bases, patterns that we have seen, all these are stored in our nerve system, in our brain actually, where they're looking for patterns. So if we see there's a fire, first time I put my hand probably when I was little, and I get a burning sensation, it says this is not something to be done. So that's a negative feedback I get, and it gets somehow into my neural net, in my network system that I have in my brain, right? And then something that I enjoy doing, it also stored in a positive way. And later on, if I face with a similar thing, my brain tells me what to do. So it's a growing up process. But the example I gave is that if, let's say, there are a lot of people here, and I put a child here, and I ask the child to leave the room, and let's say there are not static objects, there are objects that are moving around, okay? The child will take an object coming to him or her seriously, and we will just try to avoid as much as possible from the object. But the adult solves in a different way. Adults knows there is the door. So if there's an object coming this way, let's say it's coming this way, and by the time I'm approaching it, I've already crossed it, let's say, because its speed is a little slow. But I know it's coming to me, but I don't care, because by the time I've gone towards my door, it is already behind me, right? So, but that the child doesn't know. It looks at something coming to it. It just tries to go in another direction, right? Because it doesn't have the experience. So when you start an optimization algorithm, you see solutions behaving that way. So when you're developing such a thing, it will just go, when it sees one obstacle, it just goes 90 degrees away from it, okay? But it has to be specified that you start from here and go and reach that point. But it doesn't obey that. But soon, the solutions come in a more matured way that it doesn't avoid if it doesn't have to. It just keeps that direction. So there is a lot of things to learn when you actually implement an optimization algorithm to a system like this, which is dynamically evolving. You can learn the whole system of how to solve things in a better way, in a more matured way. Okay, so I'm almost there at 12, so I'll stop in 2 minutes. But if you look at all these different problems, you can't expect, I mean, these are not the all problems, but I've just showed you some of the things that I faced or I know that you have to use optimization. You can't assume the respective objective function and constraints to be differentiable or continuous. There will be discontinuities, discreteness in the search space. Variables are going to be mixed. Like we talked about, some variables being continuous, the dimensions can take any value, and some things being discrete, like, for example, I may have two or three options. I may have aluminum, copper, and iron. Maybe these are the three things for my can, okay? So only three options. On the other hand, the height can be any number. Give me any real number, I can do it, maybe, okay? So there can be mixed nature of such variables. And unfortunately, the optimization algorithms are not very good when you have mixed kinds of variables. And there can be large dimensions in many of these problems. Nonlinearity in constraints, multimodality, multi-objectivity, all these we talked about. Uncertainty I have not talked about yet, but many problems are uncertain, many variables are uncertain, which uncertain means that you specify a value, but you cannot adhere to it in practice. In practice, you'll get slightly different value, like the material. We may take the material value to be, let's say, 200 megapascal, which is the strength, but you go and buy from the market, you will not get exactly 200. There will be plus minus something. That causes a lot of havoc into the system. I think there's something coming up there. Then many of these become computationally expensive, like a CFD solver, for example. We are solving some problem where one optimization takes about a couple of days to run. Okay, so you give the run today, Only 2 days later you come and see the result. That's because every evaluation takes few minutes. And in optimization, you need to evaluate at least few hundreds, few thousand solutions. So if in 1 or 2 minutes one evaluation takes, you can easily go into a couple of days. And so we are trying to solve it through software and hardware both ways, this problem. But this is a problem that's not because algorithms are slow, it's because just the computation is so expensive. And you can't make a shortcut of that, because if you try to make too easy by using very few elements in your finite element, a time step used very small, you don't capture the mechanics or the dynamics of the problem. So you can't make it too simple. Other things are multidisciplinary. This is kind of another area now. We're kind of stabilized now, but I would say 10, 15 years ago, this has been the main thing, where everything has to be considered from a multiple discipline. Like, for example, aerospace wing, right? It has to be considered from vibration point of view, should not break. It has to be considered from aerodynamics point of view so that we get lift. Okay, so it has to be considered from the weight point of view because the whole aircraft has to be light, life, everything. So not one person can be an expert in all these different areas. That's why we have aerospace engineering, we have mechanical engineering, we have structural engineering, and all the different things. So now for designing one thing, you need to involve lots of different people. Okay, lots of different disciplines. Each of the discipline has their own objective functions and constraints and variables. So when you put everything together, there can be hundreds of variables and, you know, tens of objectives and constraints. So it becomes a huge problem. The difficulty is you can get them together. Maybe there is a fast algorithm you can use. But when you start changing everything, some department says, hey, you can't change that. Okay, I can only be between this and this. But it also depends on what you are doing. Okay, so there are a lot of linking between, and there is a hierarchy in those industries. First, for example, in a car, I know, first the axle to axle distance have to be determined before you do the cab. Okay, it doesn't make sense to do a cab and then say, hey, we designed the cab. Now it goes to the axle to axle or wheel to wheel to figure out what should be that. No, they have to design that first based on the engine power and the weight that has to be carried. Cab is the last thing. So there is a hierarchy. So when there is a hierarchy, you have to maintain that in your optimization as well. So this multidisciplinary optimization is more like a fancy thing where you have various different disciplines. All you are doing is breaking the problem into discipline-wise and trying to make a schedule that which one I should start, how shall I interact with them. So there is not much in the optimization there. It's more of the scheduling, but it's all integrated. Okay. All right. So I'm going to stop here for today. I think this much information is enough for you to solve the assignment problem in the afternoon that I have. So just look at that. It should be there behind, yeah. Yeah, the first one, it's on page 168. So we are going to be solving these two problems. Try to read before you come. So as I said, only today we're going to meet at 3. Other days we'll meet at 2. So if you have any quick question, I can look at that. Otherwise, we meet at 3. Yeah? Yeah. That means your objective function is not differentiable. There is no derivative that exists. So let's say there is a mod function you have, or there is a discrete function. X and Y are discrete values it can take. So there is no derivative for discrete variables. You can numerically also, you cannot do when you have discreteness, right? Because the next one is far away, and for the numerical gradient to be close to the actual gradient, your h should be very small. Your difference between two should be small. But if your next one is far away, you can compute it, but it may not make any sense. But there are certain problems for example, the mod function. Even numerical gradient will give you wrong information. So, yeah, there are certain difficulties with non-differentiable problems in optimization. Sorry? Mixed, I mentioned some of the variables are continuous, some of the variables are discrete, and together they describe the problem. Like I mentioned, the diameter and height can be real, continuous variable, but thickness, if that's my variable, it can come at a step of 0.1 millimeter, let's say. So 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, nothing in between. So then it's a combination of real and discrete. That's called mixed. Yeah, those will come as discrete. So if those are your variables, those will come as discrete. Yeah, so those are mixed, those are discrete variables. Yeah.
So in this the mixed variables, there was something we didn't call it permutation.
I didn't mention that. Permutation is arrangement of some numbers. For example, the travel in salesperson problem. Let's say you have 10 cities you want to travel. Name the cities as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 10. Now, one of your solution is, where shall we start? Where do you go next? Where do you go next? So one solution would be 5 to 2 to 3 to 1 to 4 to 10, like that, you know. So you write a series of numbers, each number appearing only once, so that every number appears, and there will be 10 numbers in the case of 10 city problem. So that's a permutation. When you go to another solution, it's just another ordering of these numbers. So these are numbers, but the actual value of the number doesn't make any sense. It's the order which is important. It's a sequence of numbers. So they are, which number is coming after what number? That's important. Then the actual location of these numbers. So are you going to 2 from 5, city 2 to city 5, or you are going to city 3 from city 5? That's the important thing, not when is this happening. This can happen early on. This can happen later on in your permutation, but is the order that is important. So it's a different kind of problem. These kinds of variables come in scheduling and planning, that kind of problem. No, randomization is a way to get a random solution, but permutation is a completely different kinds of variables. Yeah, you have to generate it randomly like that, but then the permutation is not an effect of randomization. That is, randomization is a way to create the permutation, but permutation has some constraints, is that every number has to come only once, okay, not more. So you cannot have two appearing twice in your whole string, right? Last question. Say it again. Guarantees part I'm going to talk about next, probably tomorrow. But very few algorithms guarantee finding the optimum. Finally, you have linear and quadratic problem. The point-based methods have some guaranteed algorithms, certain guaranteed algorithm for certain class of problems. Population based also has some guaranteed algorithms for certain types of problems, but they are so. Yeah. No, then you cannot guarantee. Yeah, cannot guarantee. So guaranteed solutions, algorithms for finding guaranteed solutions are very, very few, and the problems are also so much rare in practice that even if you don't know them, it doesn't going to matter to you. So most cases we don't have guaranteed algorithms. Okay, but those algorithms are pretty good at giving you a near optimal solution. So that's what we engineers are often happy with. But from a mathematics point of view, they may not be so good. Okay, I need to stop now and then hold your questions. Maybe for the afternoon, we can spend some time talking about those before we get to the exercise problem. Okay, thank you.